The issue is this. I just don't want anyone to endure physical pain to achieve this. Certainly not in the name of the composer.
I can't play like this. I don't know what to do. My fingers are swollen and I can't really move them.
I think I have to cancel this.
I practiced so much for months.
Ladies and gentlemen, I can only hope that no one is shocked by the clips I shared at the beginning of this video. And likewise, I hope no one feels personally targeted, including Annique Göttler. Just to make it clear, it was her injured hand and arm that we just saw. And to be honest, I'm one of Annique's admirers myself. For what she does, for her remarkable dedication in sharing music with us. And let's be honest, who doesn't spontaneously smile when she starts her videos with that famous rolling office chair? So no, my intention is not to criticize. In fact, I rarely do that. I mean criticizing, except perhaps in the case of Alexander Bonus, who should know better, I would say. My point is not to point fingers at what someone, in this case Annique, might be doing wrong, because she is doing nothing wrong. She plays her recently launched Chopin etudes at an incredibly high level. That's not the issue. The issue is this. I just don't want anyone to endure physical pain to achieve this. Certainly not in the name of the composer. Because Chopin did not want this. And that, dear viewer, is the point of this video. I will demonstrate that what Chopin had in mind with this etude cannot be this.
Okay. Damn, that is fast! Oh my god, just a little bit too fast.
But has to be this. Annique has been working on Chopin's etudes for years, and she recently released them on CD. In the lead up to this, she made several videos, and two recent videos were particularly interesting, especially because they shed light on the central focus of our study, historical tempo reconstruction. In one of those videos, the pianist questions whether the tempo Chopin prescribes for this first etude in C major is even possible. And in the video just before that, she talks about the recording session, during which she had to stop after the first 4-hour session due to a painful hand and arm. This is a unique public testimony from a contemporary top musician. It's unique in this sense that many more musicians have such complaints, and even worse, but never talk about that. How many of you know that the famous pianist Lang Lang has been battling focal dystonia for years? If you don't know what that is, this is a neural disease, especially common among pianists due to the excessive practice, particularly overwhelming the brain with too much information or impulses that need to be processed, or in our language here, due to the high tempi they play at. The brain starts to confuse fingers with each other. The pianist thinks of the third finger, but the fourth one moves. Fortunately, this is not the case with Annique, but she was at the beginning of this dreadful path for a while.
To be honest, at some point I was struggling so hard, I didn't know if I can actually finish or not. When we came to the last etude of Opus 10, I started to feel my arm. Like, I could feel that my arm was just completely out of energy and I could not really move it anymore, so we had to stop the first day there. But the real shit just started now. I already pushed myself over my limits before this last etude, so my arm was already really, really tired, and I still kept on pushing. And it turned out that my arm was like really hurtful for the rest of the day and swollen. I honestly didn't know if I can continue. I'm a little bit hurt on my right hand, or the right arm actually. It was pretty exhausting yesterday. I didn't feel it so much while I was playing, but afterwards like my hand was completely swollen and I really had to cool down everything. I hope today we can continue recording. It was at least not swollen anymore. I could still feel like the heaviness of the arm. I mean, at least it could move.
In the other video, Annique openly discusses the difficulties posed by Chopin's metronome marking. Now the question is, did Chopin really intend this extreme tempo? What Annique shares with her community in this video is a mainstream way of thinking today. In other words, this is exactly what you'll hear as a student in almost every conservatory worldwide.
I know I've studied all Chopin etudes, and during all the years of studying, people told me that I shouldn't give too much attention to the metronome number that Chopin wrote. And yes, these numbers are actually written by Chopin himself. And so many people are saying these numbers are just way too fast, it's just not doable, or at least not on the modern instrument. So this is the tempo I would usually play. It's fast, but not fast to the point that I feel like I don't have any control. So let's see how fast Chopin wants me to play that. Here is written 176 for fourth notes. Definitely faster than what I'm used to play, but I don't think that it is undoable. But you have to adjust the technique at this point a little bit, and this is what I think is quite interesting, because you would have to go even deeper into that type of technique that Chopin's forcing you to learn here.
Today, it's quite common to hear a professional pianist say that Chopin's etudes require years of study and even more practice to reach the prescribed tempo. If it's even achievable, because today many claim it's not a problem at all, just we need to practice a little bit more. But then I wonder, why not just walk the walk? Annique gives a very good reason, an excellent reason actually, why she doesn't do that. You'll get that excerpt later. First, follow me to Chopin's study room. We find ourselves in Paris on June 20th, 1833. Chopin writes a letter to his friend Ferdinand Hiller, but struggles to write, and here is why. I quote, "I write to you without knowing what my pen is scribbling, because at this moment Liszt is playing my etudes and transporting me outside of my respectable thoughts. I should like to steal from him the way to play my own etudes." We don't know any more of the context than this. Did Liszt simply play these etudes from sight, or had he practiced them? Opus 10 had just been released, so we can assume that he hadn't spent years studying them. Now, we can attribute all the devilish qualities we want to Liszt today. But the question is, could he, as a pianist, hold his ground among today's pianists in terms of technique? And the answer to that question is given by Moritz Rosenthal, Liszt's own student from 1876, in an interview he gave in 1924. And I quote, "The Liszt that I heard in 1876 and thereafter, and came to know as my friend and my teacher, has been surely equaled, if not surpassed, in technique and tone by several pianists of the present. He would be amazed at the great number of virtuosos. He would be fascinated by their musicianly tone, and he would be astonished at the tempo with which certain of his compositions are ordinarily played in our concert halls." This interview alone can open the eyes of many who look at the 19th century as an unattainable ideal of technique. Rosenthal again, he talks about technical progress, and Liszt apparently didn't mind witnessing that. And I quote, "Take for instance Liszt's own Don Juan fantasy, considered by some to be among the most difficult composition ever written for the piano. in the Chopin song, it was customary to play much slower than the air is sung upon the stage. When I was 22 years old, I played this for Liszt, and he marveled at my speed. If I should play it today, at the same speed as I played it then, people would think me to be very cautious, perhaps losing my powers. Another question. Would Liszt's 19th century students fit in a conservatory in 1924? Not at all. And here is why, again from Rosenthal. The advance in the demands upon all who play the piano has been so enormous that the student has to work today almost four times as hard as when Liszt held his master classes at Weimar. But the student today, by means of better methods, is able to accomplish so much more. 1924. Nearly a full century ago. On one side, we have Liszt, 1833. On the other, Annique Göttler, 2023. With Rosenthal's testimony in the middle, 1876-1924. With that in mind, we can almost definitely establish that, in terms of technical skill, Annique would outperform Liszt on stage easily. But how do we reconcile this with the perfect performance in 1833 in Chopin's study room by Liszt? Because Chopin did not intend his metronome markings as we interpret them today. More on that shortly. First this. Let's travel again, together, to Leipzig in 1835. Robert and Clara Schumann are looking forward to the visit of the famous composer Chopin already was. Clara managed even to convince him to play at least something. And eventually, Chopin sat at the piano and performed one of his nocturnes. Read what Clara writes about him. He was already so deeply suffering and feeble that he could only produce a forte with spasmodic movement of his whole body. It seems evident that the young, vital pianist, in the prime of her life, like for instance Annique, after years of dedication to the study of her instrument, should be capable of performing a piece by a composer who could barely produce a forte sound from a piano. Listen, I could go on for a while. For instance, we could compare Chopin's etudes in terms of difficulty with etudes written by the stage tigers, the real stage tigers of his time, Liszt, Thalberg, Hertz. We might hardly play those pieces today anymore, but that doesn't mean they don't exist. And in the light of that, Chopin certainly does not belong to the most difficult compositions of the 19th century. And if you doubt my words, read what Hans von Bülow, Liszt's most famous student, wrote in 1880 about the Chopin etudes. And with his edition of the Chopin etudes, his simple goal was this, and I quote, to make some of them, which owing to their difficulty have hitherto remained unpopularized, more accessible, particularly to the amateur, by pointing out a way to their correct study. You can't be clearer, in my opinion. With the right study method, and he gives study methods for all the etudes, by the way, these etudes are not easy, but they become accessible even to the, I would say, better amateur. And to address another point briefly, the argument of lighter forte pianos does not apply to von Bülow at all. He played on extremely heavy playing German pianos of that time, without double escapement, by the way. Compared to those pianos, a modern Steinway plays like a harpsichord. And by the way, Bülow doesn't mention the impossible Chopin metronome marks. We see that marking above the etude without comment. Accessible for amateurs, it seems. Or do you read something different?
So if you want to get faster, your right hand has to get lighter, because otherwise you are just carrying too much weight with you to press into the keys. But that simultaneously means that you can't really keep up the forte that is written there. And this actually makes sense to me, because Chopin didn't write like fortissimo or like anything else in terms of dynamics there. It's just forte, which you can also achieve with creating a big bass that's supporting the whole run. So your run, like the arpeggio itself, it can be light, but the bass has to be stable enough to still create a forte sound bass.
This approach can indeed lead to a beautiful, almost impressionistic version of this fantastic work. But when we look for Chopin's intentions, we see something different prescribed. The composer explicitly notates legato. This means the opposite of light arpeggios, especially given that they are broken chords. In this case, considering the broken chords, legato in the context of that time even means slightly over legato. And the challenge of this etude in this way lies in the right hand using a flexible, pivoting wrist to cover a larger area, legato, than what was aimed for with etudes of the like of Clementi or Kramer. This technique is absolutely impossible at the literal tempo, even at the tempo that Annique takes, but it becomes a significant challenge at the intended tempo half of what we today believe it is. Additionally, Chopin explicitly marks an accent on every quarter note. Have you ever thought of that? If we can agree on the importance of a score, then yes, what do you do with that, with these accents in the light of quarter note 176? Doesn't make any sense there. But in eighth note 176, however, these accents suddenly make a lot of sense. And let's not forget, Chopin only writes allegro. It's inconceivable that this would be beyond the reach of pianists. Because allegro, Hummel gives no less than 12, yes, 12 tempo indications faster than allegro. And to really wrap the arguments of this video up, let's look at the addition made by Hermann Scholtz. Scholtz, by the way, a friend of Brahms and Clara Schumann. Scholtz changed the metronome markings. It must be shocking to suddenly see 104 at the beginning of this etude instead of 176, right? And in a footnote, he writes the following. The figures of the metronome follow the tradition of the great Polish Chopin players. Well, the addition was made at a time when the transition from whole beat to single beat was in full swing. It's not that in Poland in the late 19th century they played this etude much slower than Chopin intended. On the contrary, it now becomes clear they played it a quarter faster than the original intention. When we translate Chopin's marking into modern terms, we get eighth note 176 or quarter note 88. 104 fits perfectly within the historical context in which more technique and higher tempi were simply seen as the only way forward. The progress of art. Think of what Rosenthal wrote. And with that, Annique perfectly closes this evolution with a tempo of about 152, even slightly faster than what even Friedheim prescribed in 1913, also in single beat. Faster than that tempo actually indeed becomes completely destructive for the piece.
And I'm not sure if I really want to perform it on that fast speed, because there are so many details inside of this work that I don't really want to miss.
So the quest for Chopin doesn't lie in an attainable future in front of us, but just behind us, around the corner. It's right within reach. You just have to want to see it.